بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الحمد لله حمدا طيبا مباركا فيه وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. We resume our lessons in Adab in the book of Kitab Adab al-Mufrad by Imam al-Bukhari. May Allah be pleased with him. And today we start our 9th chapter with the author, Allah have mercy on him, says, بَابُ يَبَرُّ وَالِدَيْهِ مَا لَمْ يَكُنْ مَعْصِيَةً. When parents, what's the ruling of parents that command us to do things, and these things entail committing a sin in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's deen? What's the hukum, what's the ruling when our parents advise us or tell us to commit a sin? Do we have to still obey their command? And do we still have to do birr? Do we still have to be kind to them? And last week we talked about how a parent curses, how a person curses his parent. And today we're talking about يَبَرُّ وَالِدَيْهِ مَا لَمْ يَكُنْ مَعْصِيَةً. So that we have to be kind to our parents, provided they don't ask us to commit a sin in Islam, which is to break one of the laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the hadith, under this chapter, Imam al-Bukhari brings three hadith. And the first hadith is a hadith of Abu Darda radiallahu an, where he says, أَوْصَانِي رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ بِتِسْعُ. That the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he gave a wasiyya, he gave advice to Abu Darda radiallahu an. And Abu Darda is one of the famous companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it was his habit to constantly advise and guide the Sahaba, advise them in what brings them good, advise them in their deen. And he advised each companion to what he saw fit, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So in this hadith, he says, أَوْصَانِي رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ بِتِسْعَ. The word tis'a, meaning 9, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to many times, this was his habit, this was his way, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he would advise anybody, or sometimes when he would make a statement, he'd say a number. Like how the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says in the hadith, اجتنبوا السبع المبيقات. Stay away from the 7 major sins, mubiqat, the sins that can destroy you. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, thalathun man kunna fi kana munafiqan khalisan. That 3 people or 3 characteristics, if they're ever found in a person, this person is a hypocrite. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would normally start a statement with a number, in order for the hearer, the person that's listening to him, to throw his attention and for him to understand all the points that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentions. So here he says, أَوْصَانِي رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ بِتِسْعَ. And this is the habit of the scholars. Like when you read the books of fiqh, you'll see that they write that wudu has, they'll talk about wudu and they'll say it's got 7 obligatory acts. When it comes to salah, they'll say it's got 14 obligatory acts. When they come to Islam, they say it's got 5 pillars. So Abu Darda radiallahu anhu, he says, أَوْصَانِي رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ بِتِسْعَ. And then the first one of these 9 things that he mentioned this in this hadith, he says, لَا تُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ شَيْئًا وَإِن قُطِّعْتَ أَوْ حُرِّقْتَ. Do not do shirk. Do not set partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because as we learned before, shirk is one of the greatest sins you can commit. إِنَّ الشِّرْكَ لَظُلْمٌ عَظِيمٌ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala feeds you. He provides for you. He brings you up. And then you direct your worship to someone else. أعوذ بالله. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to save us from shirk. So the first advice that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he gives to Abu Darda, he tells him, لا تشرك بالله. Do not set a partner with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his worship. وَإِن قُطِعْتَ أَوْ حُرِّقْتَ Even if you are taken to the extent where people cut you up in pieces, or they burn you like charcoal, even to this extent, do not utter the statement of shirk, do not commit shirk. But here, where the Prophet ﷺ says, قُطِعْتْ أَوْ حُرِّقْتْ, when a person is asked to commit shirk, and his back is against the wall, and his enemy uses violence, resorts to violence, and he resorts to abuse, physical abuse, then how the Quran speaks, and how it's mentioned in the Quran, إِلَّا وَقَلْبَهُ مُطْمَئِنٌ بِالْإِيمَانِ And this ayah, one of the companions, he was tortured, and he was asked to say a statement of kufr. So he uttered the statement of kufr. And this is authentic hadith in the books of Sunnah. And he came to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and he was upset and he was sad. And he told him, O Messenger of Allah, so-and-so tribe or so-and-so people from the people of Kufr, they tortured me. They captured me and they abused me. And they inflicted me with pain. And they asked me to utter a statement of kufr. And I said it. So the Prophet ﷺ asked him, and how was your heart? He says, my heart was peace with iman. So Prophet ﷺ told him, if they ask you to do this again, if they ask you to say this, say it, provided your heart doesn't believe what you say. So if you are tortured and you're asked to utter a statement of shirk, you've got two scenarios ahead of you. You can either be patient and enjoy that pain for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is better. You can either be patient and endure that pain for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is better for you. Or you can make things easy for yourself and utter that statement, provided your heart believes in the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the message of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then he says, وَلَا تَتْرُكَنَّ الصَّلَاةَ الْمَكْتُوبَةَ مُتَعَمِّدًا Good advice from the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says, وَلَا تَتْرُكَنَّ Do not leave an obligatory salah, مُتَعَمِّدًا with knowledge. And you know that you're missing it. So you don't miss it because you forgot. You miss it deliberately. So he says, وَلَا تَتَرُكَنَّ الصَّلَاةَ الْمَكْتُوبَ مُتَعَمِّدًا Do not miss a salah deliberately. Because how some of the scholars say, الْأَحْدَ الَّذِي بَيْنَنَا وَبَيْنَهُمْ تَرْكُ الصَّلَاةِ فَمَنْ تَرَكَهَا فَقَدْ كَفَرَ That the pact between us and them is the salah. And the people who ignore the salah, they have done something of kufr, of disbelief. And the Prophet says, وَلَا تَتْرُكَنَّ الصَّلَاةِ الْمَكْتُوبَةِ مُتَعَمِّدًا وَمَنْ تَرَكَهَا مُتَعَمِّدًا بَرِئَتْ مِنْهُ الذِّمَّةِ. That the people who deliberately miss their salah, بَرِئَتْ مِنْهُ الذِّمَّةِ. They've come out of the fold of Islam. They've come out of the fold of Islam. And then the Prophet says, وَلَا تَشْرَبَنَّ الْخَمْرِ. And this is the third piece of advice that the Messenger of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam gave Abu Darda. He says, وَلَا تَشْرَبَنَّ الْخَمْرِ. Do not drink alcohol. فَإِنَّهَا مِفْتَاحُ كُلِّ شَرٍ. Do not drink alcohol, for it is the key that leads to all evil. Do not drink alcohol, for it is the key to all evil. And there's one hadith which is authentic on the Prophet ﷺ, where he says, the one who drinks alcohol, he has committed the act of fornication with his mother and his auntie. This is the authentic hadith in the Prophet ﷺ. وَمَنْ شَرِبَ الْخَمْرِ فَعَلَ الْفَاحِشَ بِأُمِّهِ وَخَالَتِهِ. That the one who drinks alcohol, he has committed fornication with his mother and his auntie. And here the Prophet ﷺ says, وَلَا تَشْرَبَنَّ الْخَمْرِ. Do not drink alcohol. فَإِنَّهَا مِفْتَاحُ كُلِّ شَرٍ. And then the Prophet ﷺ says, وَأَطِعْ وَالِدَيْكَ. Be kind to them, obey them, acknowledge their call, fulfill their commands. وَإِنْ أَمَرَاكَ أَنْ تَخْرُجَ مِنْ دُنْيَاكَ. Even if they ask you to go to the extent of coming out of your world, if they ask you to do this, do it for them. Imam al-Bukhari brings this hadith under the chapter, يَبُرُّ وَالِدَيْهِ مَا لَمْ يَكُنْ مَعْصِيَةً. So you do birr, you be kind to your parents on one condition, provided they don't ask you to do a sin. If they ask you to do sin, you have to politely turn away, but you still have to do ma'roof. You still have to do ihsan. So you don't acknowledge their call, but you still have to do ma'roof. You still have to be kind to them. So if they ask you to do something, and that something is haram, it entails breaking a law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or breaking the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you don't have to acknowledge that call, you don't have to obey them, but you still have to be good to them, you still have to be kind to them. Like how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَإِنْ جَاهَدَاكَ عَلَىٰ أَن تُشْرِكَ بِاللَّهِ مَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ عِلْمٍ فَلَا تُطِعْهُمَا وَصَاحِبْهُمَا فِي الدُّنْيَا مَعْرُوفًا. صدق الأخير. وَصَاحِبْهُمَا فِي الدُّنْيَا مَعْرُوفًا. That don't listen to them, but وَصَاحِبْهُمَا فِي الدُّنْيَا مَعْرُوفًا. Be kind to them. So if they ask you to do something, it entails breaking the law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, do not obey, but you still have to be kind to them. وَصَاحِبْهُمَا فِي الدُّنْيَا مَعْرُوفًا. So here he says, وَأَطِعْ وَالِدَيْكَ. وَإِنْ أَمَرَاكَ أَنْ تَخْرُجَ مِنْ دُنْيَاكَ فَخْرُجْ لَهُمَا. And if they ask you to go out of your world or to go out of your dunya, so go out for them. And then he says, وَلَا تُنَازِعَنَّ وَلَاتَ الْأَمْرِ. All these pieces of advice, all this advice that the Messenger of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam gave Abu Darda, are very important. We need to take heed. We need to understand them, because they save us from a lot of evil. وَلَا تُنَازِعُنَّ وَلَا تُنَازِعُنَّ وَلَا تَلْأَمْرِ. Do not debate the people that have authority over you, your rulers. Do not attempt to remove them, because by attempting to remove them, you come with a bigger calamity and a bigger fitna. And this is why the Prophet ﷺ says in one hadith, وَإِن تَأَمَّرَ عَلَيْكُمْ عَبْدٌ حَبَشِي عَلَيْكُمْ بِالسَّمْعِ وَالطَّاعَةِ, that even if an Abyssinian slave has to make his way to the throne, then you have to listen and obey. And one hadith he says, وَإِن سَلَبَ مَالَكْ وَجَلَدَ ظَهْرَكْ, that even if your ruler has to take your money and he has to whip your back, you have to listen and obey. And Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal, the scholar, the Imam of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, he says, if I had one dua that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was to accept, I would make dua for the ruler, not against him. I'd make dua for him. Because if the ruler is pious and he's good, then the people will be good and they'll be pious. So the Prophet says, وَلَا تُنَازِعُنَّ وَلَاتَ الْأَمْرِ, that do not attempt to remove your leaders. وَإِن رَأَيْتَ أَنَّكَ أَنْتَ, even if you feel that you are more qualified, because shaitan whispers, this leader doesn't know how to sort out so-and-so problem, I can sort it out. Even if you feel that you're more qualified, and if you feel you can make a change, do not attempt to remove, do not debate them, do not in any means try and debate them or try and remove them. وَلَا تَفْرِرْ مِنَ الزَّحَفِ وَإِنْ هَلَقْتَ وَفَرَّ أَصْحَابُكَ, do not run away from battle. When you're in the battle and you find that you're losing, do not run away. Even if your friends run away, running away from the battle is one of the major sins. Running away from battle is one of the major sins. And there's only one condition where someone is allowed to run away: to run from a battle so that he can give aid to another battle. Because the Prophet ﷺ says here, وَلَا تَفْرِرْ مِنَ الزَّحَفِ وَإِنْ هَلَكْتَ وَفَرَّ أَصْحَابُكَ, that do not run away from a battle, even if you see that you're at the verge of being killed and your friends have left you. Then he says, وَأَنْفِقْ مِنْ طَوْلِكْ عَلَىٰ أَهْلِكَ, that feed your family from the pure earnings that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you. And there's a hadith in the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that whatever you give your family, whatever you feed your wife is sadaqah. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says here, وَأَنْفِقْ مِنْ طَوْلِكْ عَلَىٰ أَهْلِكَ, that feed your family from your earnings, your halal earnings. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, وَلَا تَرْفَعْ عَصَاكَ عَنْ أَهْلِكَ, that do not make it be your habit where you have a whip and you have to whip your family. And in Arabic, your family can also mean your wife. وَلَا تَرْفَعْ عَصَاكَ عَنْ أَهْلِكَ, do not make it a habit where you have to whip your family. Whipping your family, your children, it's one way, it's one medium, it's one way, one method to try and bring discipline and discipline them. But it's not the only way. It's not the only way. And if you resort to whipping them, then it has to be done in a way where they're not marked. You don't mark their body. You don't mock their body, you don't break a bone. And then he says, وَأَخِفْهُمْ فِي اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ. And your family, constantly remind them to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this last point that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentions, this is advice to all teachers, parents, people that have authority, when you have people that you are responsible over, even at the workplace. How many times do we try and instill fear because of our positions? The manager is going to look at you, the manager is going to do this, the director is going to do this. At home, I'm going to do this to you, I'm going to do this to you. You threaten your family, you threaten the people around you. But if you remind them of fearing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that they're constantly watched, and that Allah watches them, is ever watching over them, He sees them, and He's going to reward them over their actions. If it's good, He'll reward them with good. And if it's bad, He'll reward them with bad. So this is good advice from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that he gave Abu Darda radiallahu anhu. And in another hadith, وعن عبد الله بن عمر رضي الله عنه قال جاء رجل إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. عبد الله بن عمر says a man came to the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم and he says جئت أبايعك على الهجرة. A man came and said, I've come to agree that I will do hijrah. Hijrah is when you move from a non-Islamic country to an Islamic country. This is what you call hijrah. So if you move from America to Qatar, this is hijrah. If you do it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is hijrah. وَتَرَقْتُ أَبَوَيَّ يَبْكِيَانِ. And I left my parents crying. They were crying because they had the son and he did hijrah. And now who's going to be there for them? So he says, irji' ilayhima. When the Prophet ﷺ heard this, he told him, go back to your parents. فَأَضْحِكْهُمَا كَمَا أَبْكَيْتَهُمَا. Make them laugh, make them smile, just like how you left them crying. We notice in this hadith, Imam al-Bukhari brings this hadith under the heading, يَبُرُّ وَالِدَيْهِ مَا لَمْ يَكُنْ مَعْصِيًا. That he is kind to his parents, provided it doesn't entail a sin, committing a sin. Under this chapter, Imam al-Bukhari brings this hadith. This man came and made a pledge to the Prophet ﷺ that he'll do hijrah. And hijrah is one of the most beloved deeds to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hijrah is one of the most loved deeds to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When someone leaves a land where people are corrupt and there's vice and there's sins, and he goes to the land of Islam, where you find the signs of the Quran and the Sunnah, you find the signs of Islam, and this person can benefit, he benefits with all the goodness that's around him. Hijrah is a loved ibadah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala if it's done for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this man, he pledged the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam on hijrah. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told him, how did you leave your parents? So he says, taraktu abawayya yabkiyan. I left them and they were crying. So he says, irji' ilayhima. Go back to them. Wa'adhikhuma, fa'adhikhuma kama abkaytahuma. That make them smile after you made them cry. And another hadith on the same companion, عبد الله بن عمرو رضي الله عنه قال جاء رجل إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يريد الجهاد. In another hadith, Abdullah ibn Amr says, a man came to the Prophet ﷺ and he wanted to fight in jihad. So the Messenger of Allah ﷺ asked him, Ahayyun waridak? Are your parents alive? So he says, yes. Na'am. Qala fafihima fajahid. That do your jihad in your parents. Because when a person has parents, there's also jihad in this. It's not a jihad where you have arrows and spears and daggers flying around, but it's jihad of your nafs. The fact that you have to please them. You're tired, but they tell you to do something and you have to do it. You might be hungry, but you have to take them somewhere because they have to go at that particular time. And this is all type of jihad. The fact that you compose yourself and you go through this, all this pain, you want to eat, you want to rest, you've just come back from work, but you've got to take them out to see the doctor because no one else will do it, especially if they don't have any other children other than you. You have to help them financially. Sometimes you can have family problems, and all this is jihad. So Prophet ﷺ told him, فَفِيهِمَا فَجَاهِدْ, that do jihad in your parents by striving in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, enduring those difficulties solely for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is your jihad. And then in another hadith, in another chapter, Imam al-Bukhari says, بَابُ مِنْ أَدْرَكَ وَالِدَيْهِ فَلَمْ يَدْخُلْ الْجَنَّةِ. Wallahi al-Azim, this is also a very important, a very touching hadith. It's one hadith under this chapter. بَابُ مَنْ أَدْرَكَ وَالِدَيْهِ فَلَمْ يَدْخُلْ الْجَنَّةِ. A person, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses him with the ability to go to Jannah. He blesses him with an opportunity, but he doesn't take it. He doesn't use it. مَنْ أَدْرَكَ وَالِدَيْهِ. Allah gives him health to see his parents. Because sometimes your parents can die when you're young. Like we have Aitam. And sometimes your parents, you can lose your parents while you were a teenager. And then someone, Allah blesses him with the opportunity to go to Jannah by looking after his parents, but he doesn't use it. He doesn't use the benefits that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses him with. فَلَمْ يَدْخُلِ الْجَنَّةِ. And he doesn't go to Jannah. Abu Huraira radiallahu an al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam qal, رَغِمَ أَنْفُهُ رَغِمَ أَنْفُهُ رَغِمَ أَنْفُهُ. Abu Huraira radiallahu on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, رَغِمَ أَنْفُهُ. Raghim anfu is an expression that they say in Arabic. That raghim anfu, may you put your nose in sand. Raghim anfu. He said it three times, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Abu Huraira said, Ya Rasulullah, man, who is this that you speak three times and you say this and this and this and this? So he says, Man adraka walidayhi عنده الكبر أو أحدهما فدخل النار. That a person, he sees one of his parents, he sees both of his parents in the state of old age, when they're weak and they're now dependent, they need someone to take them to the bathroom, they need someone to walk them here and here, they become dependent. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives this person, he gives him this ni'mah of seeing his parents in this state where he can help them, but he doesn't help them. فَدَخَلَ النَّارِ. And because he doesn't help his parents, he goes to the fire of Jahannam. وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to save us from the fire of Jahannam, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to save us from the fire of Jahannam, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us amongst the people that look after their parents in old age. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in.